5.5, optimization. We said optimizing is like finding maximums or minimums of things, right? So here's the process. We said, draw a picture, make a key, write an equation. Word problems. That's the first thing I think of. Draw a picture, write a key, write an equation. But here we're going to have two equations, an objective equation and a constraint equation. The objective function is the function that will be maximized or minimized. I find that that typically shows up in the last sentence, right? Find the maximum of this. Find the minimum of this. What's the largest? What's the smallest? 3, identify constraint equation. This can be found by information in the problem and some quantity, right? This is an equation. It equals a number. So then we solve the constraint equation for one variable and substitute it into the objective equation. This will leave you with an objective equation with one variable. Once you have an equation with one variable, we do the derivative, find the max or min, do the derivative, set it equal to 0, solve. And then the last step is make sure you answer the question, right? Answer the question, because whatever you do the derivative of, that might not necessarily be the answer. Okay, so we did a box problem. Let's do number 3. Okay, Farmer Brown, the famous Farmer Brown. Farmer Brown has 6,000 feet of fence to create a rectangular pen that is adjacent to a river. He does not need a fence next to the river. He wants to partition the fence into two separate areas, one for his cows and one for his pigs. What are the dimensions of the fence that will maximize the area of the fence? Okay. So we need to draw a picture, make a key, write an equation. So he has a fence. It's next to a river. Doesn't need a fence along the river. It's partitioned into two pieces. He wants to partition, right? Partition means to split it up. He wants to partition the fence into two separate areas. Cool, drew it. Now let's make some variables. Maybe I'll call this X, maybe I'll call this Y. So where's the number in our... So we don't need to make a key because X is one side, Y is the other side, right? So that's why I didn't quite make a key. Gabriel, you had something to say?
Would you need to do X times Y is equal to 6,000 feet?
So 6,000 feet is the number. He has 6,000 feet of fence. So that's our...
That's the perimeter.
Constraint. Our constraint equation is kind of perimeter, right?
But instead it would be like Y plus 3X.
Equals 6,000. So 6,000, he has 6,000 feet of fence to create a rectangular pen. He has 6,000 feet of fence. That's the total length of fence, right? 6,000 feet of fence is total length of fence. If I add up all the sides plus the length of the partition, that's the total length of fence, right? So X plus Y plus X plus X. So 3x plus y equals 6,000, length of fence. That's our constraint equation. So what we didn't write down our objective equation yet. Right now we wrote down our constraint equation, and that's the one that equals a number. Now we need to solve, step 4 says solve the constraint equation for one variable and substitute it into the objective equation. Okay, so let's solve this for one variable. What do you want to solve for?
X.
I feel like solving for y is easier. If you solve for x, you're going to divide by 3 and you're going to have fractions. So I say solve for y because it looks a little easier to me. Okay, now let's identify the objective equation. So objective equation, I'm going to read the last sentence. What are the dimensions of the fence that will maximize area? Okay, so I need to maximize the area. That's what I'm trying to optimize. It's saying what are the dimensions of the fence? Great, but I need an equation for the area of the fence. Area equals what? X times Y. All right, good. Now I'm going to substitute in my constraint equation. A equals x times 6,000 minus 3x. So I need to do the derivative of this. So I could do product rule, or I can distribute and then just do power rule. So A equals 6,000x minus 3x squared. All right, now let's do the derivative. A prime equals 6,000 minus 6x. I'm trying to find the maximum or minimum of the area, so I need to set that equal to 0. So I get 6x equals 6,000. X equals 1,000. Okay, so we did step 5. Find the maximum or minimum of the objective equation now that it has one variable. Okay, now we need to answer the question. So what is the question actually asking?
What are the dimensions of the fence that we have to make the area?
Good, so what are the dimensions of the fence? So I know what X is. What is Y? How'd you get that, David? You can plug X in here. So answer the question. So answer the question, X equals 1,000. And then I can use this equation up here. Y equals 6,000 minus 3 times X, 3 times 1,000. So you get Y equals 3,000. What are my units? So answer the question, right? Okay, good.
Do we have to test to make sure it's a maximum?
Sure, we can test to make sure it's a maximum. Check to see if it's a maximum. X equals 1,000. What are some test points you want to do? Let me do my 0, 1,001. So f prime of 0, here's f prime. F prime of 0 equals 6,000, which is positive, so increasing. F prime of 101 is going to be negative. Or sorry, 1,001. So it's decreasing, so it is a maximum. Good. Yeah, I plugged it back into the solved constraint equation. So maybe we can box that in next time. So the thing is this says, what are the dimensions? It could have asked you, what's the maximum area, right? If it asked the maximum area, where would I plug that in? I would plug that in here, is where I would plug it in. I wouldn't solve for y first and then do it. I would plug it in here and be a little lazy. If I get x equals this, I would plug it in here to find the maximum area. So I'll box that in as the objective equation of one variable. All right. You guys good? All right, next page. Got it all copied? All right, next. The U.S. Post Office says that packages have to be box-shaped. All right, so that tells us what we're looking at. With the sum of the length, width, and height not exceeding 108 inches. What are the dimensions of the box with a square base that has the largest volume? Oh, my goodness, I need to draw a picture. So I have a box with a square base. Ooh, look out, my drawing skills are getting good today. Okay, so if it has a square base, what do I need to label my slides? We already did an example really similar to this, right? Yeah, number 2 was very similar to this. So tell me some ways to label my box with a square base. Sure, A, A, Y, good. Sometimes I do X as Y, sometimes I do length with height, whatever you feel, whatever you want to do, right? Okay, what's my constraint?
Y plus A squared equals 1. Okay.
Good, so there's my number, and it says the sum of the length, width, and height not exceed 108 inches. So that means A plus Y equals 108. So I have 2A plus Y equals 108. So again, I would solve for Y in this situation. So I don't have fractions. So Y equals 108 minus 2A. I'll box in that constraint equation. Now, what's my objective equation? So remember, the objective equation is what I'm trying to maximize or minimize. So I underlined largest volume. So what's the volume of a box?
It's going to be Y times A squared.
So it's length times width times height is volume of a box. In terms of the variables here, it's A squared times Y. All right, so now I need to substitute for Y. I get volume equals A squared times 108. Minus 2a. Now I'm going to distribute again. If you want to do product rule, go for it, but I think product rule and then cleaning up and then setting it equal to 0 is going to be a little bit more than just distributing now. Okay, so that's my constraint equation for one variable. Now I'm going to take the derivative of the constraint equation and set it equal to 0. Can somebody help me? Yeah, I would factor out an a because this is a quadratic function. I have a squared, it's quadratic, so you factor out an a. 216 minus 6a equals 0, so I set each of those equal to 0. A equals 0, and 216 minus 6a equals 0. So obviously a equals 0 would make it not a box, so not helpful, right? So 6a equals 216. A equals what, David?
A equals 54. No, wait, 3 times the square root of 6.
What is it? It's not.
It's 36.
36? What'd you do? If you have the square root, you must have factored wrong somehow. Okay, so A equals 36. Okay, so now answer. So now let's check to see if it's max or min.
Well, in the Y, why should it equal 108 minus?
Okay. So check to see if it's a max. We have a equals 36. I'm going to choose something to the right, choose something to the left. I mean, does it make sense that it's a max?
Yes.
Look at the derivative. The derivative is a parabola, negative lead coefficient, so it's opening up. So it is a max. There's only a max for that one. But if you guys want to check it, we can. Okay, we'll check it. So f prime of 36, here's my, f prime of 0 is 0. Oh, that's not helpful. Yep, because that was a critical value, right? Okay, let's do f prime of 1. If I put 1 in here, it's going to be greater than 0, right? I get 216 minus 6, that's positive. What about 37? Might need to put that in the calculator. But it's a parabola, so I know that it's... So it is a max. Okay, so now answer the question. So the question is, what are the dimensions of the box? So what are the dimensions of the box? The dimensions are A equals 36. What is it? What are my units? Inches. And Y equals, I'm going back to the constraint equation, 108 minus 2 times A, 2 times 36 is what? 36? So, what are we saying then about this box?
It's a cube.
So all these steps are necessary, but if you ever have to find a rectangle with no partitions with the largest area, it's always going to be a square. The previous problem we did, it had a partition and not one side, so that changes things. But if you ever have to find the dimensions of a rectangle with a maximum area, it's always a square. Just like here, if you ever have to find a box with the largest volume, it's a cube. I think number two that we did, though, that one had an open top, so that one was different, right? How are you guys feeling about this?
This seems a lot easier than
Does it?
This feels like stuff that I did in my high school algebra class. Like, it's not the derivative part, but like the whole draw a picture of it's easier that way.
I can tell you I did this problem in my college algebra class. So how did I do it in college algebra without using calculus, is my question. It's the same process, but we don't know the derivative, right? So this function is a quadratic equation with lead coefficient being negative, so it's a parabola. The maximum or minimum of a parabola is its vertex. There's a formula for the vertex of a parabola that does not include calculus. I think I had a problem almost exactly like this on my
muscles. Is the formula for vertex, is that what the negative b over 2a
thing? F of negative b over 2a, yeah. It's a point, right?
Okay. I was just trying to remember.
Yeah. Really good. So, but that's why this one can be. So what seems really hard? Related rates is hard, I know, for people. Is that really hard? Related rates? What could make it easier then? I'm always looking for tips to make things easier for students. I think I try to do like steps like this so that if you guys are trying to do something getting lost, go back and check your steps. I think I kind of try to do that with related rates. Related rates is always draw a picture, make a key, find your equation, whatever your equation is, do d every letter over dt, and try to fill that in from the word problem. Do you think related rates was super hard?
I like that one.
I like it too. What was really hard? Well, I mean, we do have a day to review before the final. So keep in mind what's really difficult. If there was something that was really difficult, come to my office hours before finals and get that figured out. Because chances are, if it was on a test, it's going to show up again on the final, right?
Is the final just all the bunch of questions from the previous test and then some new stuff from like this unit? Or it's like...
I mean, I'm not recycling questions. But I would assume it would be similar questions. I mean, it's similar topics if I could ask it in a different way, right? Like, related rates is going to be on there. Obviously, an optimization is going to be on there, right? So, for related rates, we did a ladder. So, it's not going to be the ladder one. Let's look through the notes and homework and see what else we did, right? What numbers can I change? Instead of it being a ladder, can it be, I don't know. A water slide falling down, that would be really dangerous.
What day is Monday?
It's on the syllabus. Okay, let's do another one. You guys feel like this is easy?
Yeah.
You guys want to give this one a shot by yourself? Okay, so let me talk through it. So find the point on the line y equals 4x plus 7, which is closest to the point 0, 0. Okay, so I can't really draw a picture. You want me to draw a picture of a line? And a point? We can graph it, right? What does this line look like? 7 and the slope is 4, right? So it's something kind of like this, not exactly to scale, and then here's the point 0, 0. So if I'm trying to find the point closest, the point on this line that's closest, what am I doing?
Are you like making a triangle?
You could, sure.
And you could solve for the sides.
Okay. I mean, it looks like a triangle right here, yeah. So, do you guys know what the point that's closest is? Do you know a relationship? Any sort of relationship?
To the origin?
The relationship to the point. It's going to be, so this tells, I'm telling you how to do it without using calculus, really, is what I'm doing here. So it's that point right there that if you drew a triangle, it would be perpendicular. So if you know, I'm telling you the college algebra way to do it. This is y equals 4x plus 7. What's the equation of a perpendicular line? What do you know about perpendicular lines and their slope? Do you guys remember? Well, it's opposite sign, right? This is positive, this is negative. Yeah, opposite sign, inverse. So if this slope is 4, this blue line has a slope of negative 1 over 4. So it's the opposite sign and reciprocal. Don't write this down, this isn't calculus. So you can find the equation of a line with a slope negative 1 fourth that goes through the point 0, 0. You can do that, right? That's college algebra. Let's use calculus, though. If we're looking for the point closest, what does that mean? Maximum or minimum what?
It doesn't have a maximum. It's the same case. It's just a straight line.
Well, this is the non-calculus way to do it, right? But the fact that the closest means it's perpendicular is a concept you'll see in the future. I mean, we didn't prove it or anything, but I mean, we're about to kind of. So the question is, what am I trying to maximize or minimize? My constraint equation is just y equals 4x plus 7. It's already solved for one variable, right? Objective equation. What am I? I'm finding the closest, which means I'm finding the minimum distance, right? Closest means minimum distance. So what's the formula for the distance between two points? That's slope. That's slope. This is the distance formula. It is the Pythagorean theorem, right? The distance between two points, if I make this into a triangle, this is x1, y1, x2, y2. Y2 minus, or this is x2 minus x1, this is y2 minus y1, and then this is the distance, right? If I do Pythagorean theorem for that, I get this squared equals this squared plus this squared, right? It's Pythagorean theorem. So square root d. Distance formula is Pythagorean theorem. Right? Okay. So, okay, I have x1, I have x2, oh my goodness. So I can say x2, y2 is 0, and change x1 to x, because I don't know what that point is. So x minus 0 squared plus y minus 0 squared is my distance. Now I need to plug my constraint equation into my objective equation, and I'm going to get rid of the zeros. And I plugged my point into. So this is x squared plus 4x plus 7 squared. Okay, somebody square this for me. Sixteen x squared, 4 times 7 is what? 28 times 2. 56. 7 squared is. Okay, so here I have the square root of 17x squared, plus 56x plus 49. Okay, so that is my constraint equation in one variable. So I'm going to box that in, and I think we're going to have to finish it next class. But the next step is take the derivative and set it equal to 0, right? Don't forget derivative B, y'all.